Imagine being a queen ant, and you've just recently mated after the biggest night of your life, known as the ant nuptial flight, and you're now on your way to becoming the queen of your own colony. You've settled into your founding chamber, and are now waiting to lay your first batch of ant eggs, which you can already feel developing inside you. But in the coming days, you notice that something just doesn't feel right. Some peculiar pains come and go within your gaster. That's funny, but perhaps this is all part of ant motherhood. Over the next few days, the pains continue to grow stronger and more unbearable. And soon, you feel your babies moving around within you. And wait, something's definitely wrong now. You suddenly find yourself no longer able to breathe. And the pain is just excruciating. It's as if your babies are devouring your breathing organs, as well as all of your insides. It's at this point you realize that something is very wrong. In fact, you realize now that all this time, you haven't been incubating your own babies. You've been incubating something else. And it's every queen ant's nightmare. Your moments from exploding and giving birth to alien babies that are not of your species. Welcome to the savagery of Mother Nature and to the AntsCanada Ant Channel. Please subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon. Welcome to the AC family. Enjoy. So here I have a queen ant from my recent queen ant collection that I highly suspect is about to explode from endoparasitic maggots, i.e. ant fly larvae. My other queens have gone on to lay normal ant eggs, as usual. But this queen didn't, and is clearly incubating something else that has been growing inside her. Now, I've been struggling to decide how to deal with this situation. But thankfully, in last week's video, you guys helped me decide the ultimate fate of this infected queen ant. So stay tuned as I carry out that fate at the end of the video. Of course, trigger warning, for all of you taking front row seats to witness the gore, you will all see real footage of these endoparasitic maggots bursting forth into the world, so brace yourselves. But first, some of you might be asking, AntsCanada, how did these maggots end up in the queen ant in the first place? Well, AC family, let us now delve into the crazy world of ant endoparasites. Ants have to deal with a variety of crazy endoparasites. Endo meaning internal parasites. These parasites are extremely specialized in infecting specific ant species. Have a look at this real quick. The ant on the left is a healthy worker ant, but the ant on the right is infected with a nematode species, i.e. roundworms. Now AC family, check out how the nematodes get into the ant in the first place. The nematodes inside this worker ant cause the ant's gaster to swell up and turn a bright red color. And it just so happens that the ant's now bright red gaster greatly resembles berries. Then, a bird comes along and eats the ant, thinking it's a berry. The nematodes then enter the bird's digestive system, mate, breed, and lay eggs within the bird. Then the bird poops, and with it releases all the nematode eggs. And as we've already seen on the channel, ants love to eat bird poop. And the consumed bird poop with nematode eggs gets taken back to the ant nest, where it is fed to the ant larvae. And it is in the ant larvae that the eggs remain until each larva matures into an adult ant, and the cycle begins all over again. Isn't that just crazy? This particular species of nematode requires both the ants and the birds in order to survive. That's how specialized they are. So then how do maggots end up in a queen ant? Well, AC family, there are two possibilities. The first possibility is that this queen ant may have consumed the egg somehow at some stage of her life. And it could have been as early as the larval stage, like in the nematode example you saw earlier. But I suspect it is probably highly unlikely that the queen did consume the eggs at larval stage, because it does seem like the maggots require a queen host. And unless the fly eggs have some way of taking over the worker ant's brains to ensure the eggs are fed to queen ant larvae, then it seems the fly eggs have a not so good chance of scoring a queen among the millions of worker ant babies. I suspect the ant parasitic fly uses a second method to get its maggots into the queen ant. From the outside, there are hundreds of ant parasitic flies that only need a split second to lay their eggs on the exoskeleton of an ant to parasitize them with its maggots. For instance, we know of some 300 species of flies that are known as ant-decapitating flies of the genus Apocephalus. And one such species of ant-decapitating fly dive bombs a fire ant and in a split second lays an egg onto its exoskeleton. The maggot hatches from the egg and burrows into the body of the fire ant, where it further develops and feeds on the ant's insides. Then when the maggot pupates, it enters the head, causing the head to fall off. And from the ant's dead head emerges the adult ant-decapitating fly, ready to mate and begin the cycle all over again. So, going back to this unlucky queen ant of ours, I highly suspect that if there are indeed maggots about to explode from inside her, that they're of a species of fly that, one, specializes in parasitizing this particular species of carpenter ant, and two, enters the queen from eggs laid onto the exoskeleton of the queen ant during the biggest night of her life, the nuptial flight. My guess is an ant parasitic fly laid some eggs onto this unlucky queen ant during her nuptial flight, and the tiny maggots that hatched from the eggs burrowed into her body and began to feed on any ant eggs she might have had developing in her body, as well as all her innards. And now, AC family, it's the moment we've all been waiting for. Let's have a look at the gruesome process of the maggot explosion from a queen's gaster, shall we? I hope you all aren't eating right now. Moments before the parasitic maggots are about to emerge, they can be seen seething and slithering below the surface of the membrane of the queen ant's gaster. At this point, the queen ant is dead because the maggots have eaten all of her insides now. The maggots are now compelled to burrow out of the queen's body in order to pupate and form cocoons for their next stage of development. One maggot manages to chew through and peeks out into the world. It emerges and begins to crawl around. This begins a chain reaction of more and more maggots emerging from the hole, until suddenly, the queen's body lies under a huge pile of seething maggots. Ugh, so gross! I hate maggots, and they make my skin crawl. Sorry, this is my scolecophobia talking now, but hey, it's science. Let's keep watching. These large maggots are at their final larval stage and wander off the dead body of the queen ant in search of a safe location to spin a cocoon and develop into adult flies, which will then go on to breed and lay their eggs on other unsuspecting queen ants during their nuptial flight. So disgusting. Thank God I'm not a queen ant. Now, going back to our queen ant here, now that we know the possible fate of this queen, what do you think we should do with her? When I showed this infected queen ant in last week's video, many of you left the same comment saying the most ethical thing to do is euthanize this queen and relieve her of her future suffering. I mean, look at this post with 2,000 likes. Even your AC Senate voted that we should go the humane route of euthanasia and save her from her misery. And so you, the powers, have spoken. I even considered the possibility that this queen might actually have no parasites inside her at all, despite the signs that she did. But even so, she wasn't going to lay eggs, she wasn't going to found her own ant colony, and she was going to die anyway. And so, AC family, I really hated to do it, but it was for the best. I placed her into the freezer, so she, along with any of the parasites within her, would die by freezing. Goodbye, queen ant. Perhaps you'll reincarnate and successfully found a thriving ant colony in your next lifetime. In terms of the other queen ants, it seems 8 of the 14 we caught a few weeks ago are well on their way to founding their own ant colonies. Look at the size of the larvae now of queen number 6 from last week's video. It's indeed the bittersweet story of nature that some animals succeed to make it to their later stages of life fulfilling their purpose in the ecosystem and making it far enough to pass their genes into the next generation, while others become the sacrificial lambs to allow other life forms to continue on. Though we can all call these maggots horrid and gross, and trust me, I still find them horrid and gross no matter what. Inside, I do know that the parasitic maggots don't really have a choice regarding how their species proliferates in the world. The maggots are just living the way nature designed them to be, and it just so happens that nature designed them to kill off unlucky queen ants. Perhaps they help in regulating ant populations. I realized that in nature, there is no emotional bias. Life only tends to survival and further promotion of life, and that's just the way it's been for billions of years, since life's very genesis on the planet. As I looked at the eight queens all tending to their respective first generation of worker ants, I realized that Mother Nature, though at times savage, is still incredibly perfect in design. Thank you for watching and supporting the ants. It's ant love forever. AC family, did you enjoy today's episode? Did you learn something new? Follow these continuing real-life ant stories by smashing that subscribe button and bell icon now, and hit all so you get notified at every upload. And don't forget to hit the like button every single time, including now. It would really mean a lot to me, guys. Thank you. AC and her colony, I have left a hidden cookie for you here. If you would like to watch extended play footage of the maggots bursting forth from the queen ant, go check that out, if you dare. And guys, did you know that it's anting season in the Northern Hemisphere, and you don't even need to leave your home to start an ant colony? You can catch pregnant queen ants from the safety of your own backyard, balcony, or open window starting this month. Be sure to visit AntsCanada.com for all your ant keeping and collecting gear shipped to you in a special package from our ant-loving facility in the USA. So you can get the most out of your ant-keeping experience. We ship worldwide and also offer full email support if you need our help. We also have a helpful forum and ant colony trading marketplace on the site. Visit AntsCanada.com today. And now it's time for the AC question of the week. Last week we asked, what does a queen ant feed her first set of larvae? Congratulations to Ugor Aksoy, who answered, a nutritious soup of her back muscle tissue that powered her wings before she shed them. Congratulations, Ugor, you just won a free ultimate ant keeping handbook from our shop. In this week's AC question of the week, we ask, what type of flies belong to the genus Apocephalus? Leave your answer in the comment section, and you could also win a free ultimate ant keeping handbook from our shop. Hope you can subscribe to the channel as we upload every Saturday at 8 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Please remember to like, comment, share, and subscribe if you enjoyed this video to help us keep making more. It's ant love forever.